Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Artificial Intelligence for Dummies by John Mueller and Luca Massaron. Narrated by Chris Sorensen. Introduction. You can hardly avoid encountering mentions of AI today. You see AI in the movies, in books, in the news, and online. AI is part of robots, self-driving cars, drones, medical systems, online shopping sites, and all sorts of other technologies that affect your daily life in so many ways. Many pundits are burying you in information and disinformation about AI, too. Some see AI as cute and fuzzy. Others see it as a potential mass murderer of the human race. The problem with being so loaded down with information in so many ways is that you struggle to separate what's real from what is simply the product of an overactive imagination. Much of the hype about AI originates from the excessive and unrealistic expectations of scientists, entrepreneurs, and business persons. Artificial Intelligence for Dummies is the book you need if you feel as if you really don't know anything about a technology that purports to be an essential element of your life. Using various media as a starting point, you might notice that most of the useful technologies are almost boring. Certainly no one gushes over them. AI is like that, so ubiquitous as to be humdrum. You're even using AI in some way today. In fact, you probably rely on AI in many different ways. You just don't notice it because it's so mundane. Artificial Intelligence for Dummies makes you aware of these very real and essential uses of AI. A smart thermostat for your home may not sound very exciting, but it's an incredibly practical use for a technology that has some people running for the hills in terror. Of course, Artificial Intelligence for Dummies also covers the really cool uses for AI. For example, you may not know there is a medical monitoring device that can actually predict when you might have a heart problem, but such a device exists. AI powers drones, drives cars, and makes all sorts of robots possible. You see AI used today in all sorts of space applications, and AI figures prominently in all the space adventures humans will have tomorrow. In contrast to many books on the topic, Artificial Intelligence for Dummies also tells you the truth about where and how AI can't work. In fact, AI will never be able to engage in certain essential activities and tasks, and won't be able to do other ones until far into the future. Some people try to tell you that these activities are possible for AI, but Artificial Intelligence for Dummies tells you why they can't work, clearing away all the hype that has kept you in the dark about AI. One takeaway from this book is that humans will always be important. In fact, if anything, AI makes humans even more important because AI helps humans excel in ways that you frankly might not be able to imagine. About this book. Artificial Intelligence for Dummies starts by helping you understand AI, especially what AI needs to work and why it has failed in the past. You also discover the basis for some of the issues with AI today, and how those issues might prove to be nearly impossible to solve in some cases. Of course, along with the issues, you also discover the fixes for some problems and consider where scientists are taking AI in search of answers. For a technology to survive, it must have a group of solid applications that actually work. It also must provide a payback to investors with the foresight to invest in the technology. In the past, AI failed to achieve critical success because it lacked some of these features. AI also suffered from being ahead of its time. True AI needed to wait for the current hardware to actually succeed. Today, you can find AI used in various computer applications and to automate processes. It's also relied on heavily in the medical field and to help improve human interaction. AI is also related to data analysis, machine learning, and deep learning. Sometimes these terms can prove confusing, so one of the reasons to listen to Artificial Intelligence for Dummies is to discover how these technologies interconnect. AI has a truly bright future today because it has become an essential technology. This book also discussed the paths that AI is likely to follow in the future. The various trends discussed in this book are based on what people are actually trying to do now. The new technology hasn't succeeded yet, but because people are working on it, it does have a good chance of success at some point. Icons used in this book. As you listen to this book, you'll hear icons that indicate material of interest, or not, as the case may be. This section briefly describes each icon in this book. Tip. Tips are nice because they help you save time or perform some task without a lot of extra work. The tips in this book are time-saving techniques or pointers to resources that you should try in order to get the maximum benefit from learning about AI. Warning. We don't want to sound like angry parents or some kind of maniacs, but you should avoid doing anything marked with a warning icon. Otherwise, you could find that you engage in the sort of disinformation that has people terrified of AI today. Technical stuff. Whenever you hear this icon, think advanced tip or technique. You might find these tidbits of useful information just too boring for words, or they could contain the solution you need to create or use an AI solution. Skip these bits of information whenever you like. Remember, if you don't get anything else out of a particular chapter or section, remember the material marked by this icon. This text usually contains an essential process or bit of information that you must know to interact with AI successfully. Beyond the book. This book isn't the end of your AI discovery experience. It's really just the beginning. We provide online content to make this book more flexible and better able to meet your needs. That way, as John receives email from you, we can address questions and tell you how updates to AI or its associated technologies affect book content. In fact, you'll gain access to all these cool additions. Cheat sheet. You remember using crib notes in school to make a better mark on a test, don't you? You do? Well, a cheat sheet is sort of like that. It provides you with some special notes about tasks that you can do with AI that not everyone else knows. You can find the cheat sheet for this book by going to dummies.com and searching for Artificial Intelligence for Dummies Cheat Sheet. The cheat sheet contains really neat information, such as the meaning of all those strange acronyms and abbreviations associated with AI, machine learning, and deep learning. Updates. Sometimes changes happen. For example, we might not have seen an upcoming change when we looked into our crystal balls during the writing of this book. In the past, that simply meant that the book would become outdated and less useful, but you can now find updates to the book by going to dummies.com and searching this book's title. In addition to these updates, check out the blog posts with answers to readers' questions and for demonstrations of useful book-related techniques at blog.johnmullerbooks.com. Where to go from here? It's time to start discovering AI and see what it can do for you. If you don't know anything about AI, start with Chapter 1. You may not want to listen to every chapter in the book, but starting with Chapter 1 helps you understand AI basics that you need when working through other places in the book. If your main goal in listening to this book is to build knowledge where AI is used today, start with Chapter 5. The materials in Part 2 help you see where AI is used today. Listeners who have a bit more advanced knowledge of AI can start with Chapter 9. Part 3 of this book contains the most advanced material that you'll encounter. If you don't want to know how AI works at a low level, not as a developer but simply as anyone interested in AI, you might decide to skip this part of the book. Okay, so you want to know the super fantastic ways in which people are either using AI today or will use AI in the future. If that's the case, start with Chapter 12. All of Parts 4 and 5 discuss the incredible ways in which AI is used without forcing you to deal with piles of hype as a result. The information in Part 4 focuses on hardware that relies on AI, and the material in Part 5 focuses on more futuristic uses of AI. 1. Introducing AI. Chapter 1. Introducing AI. Artificial intelligence, AI, has had several false starts and stops over the years, partly because people don't really understand what AI is all about or even what it should accomplish. A major part of the problem is that movies, television shows, and books have all conspired to give false hopes as to what AI will accomplish. In addition, the human tendency to anthropomorphize, give human characteristics to technology, makes it seem as if AI must do more than it can hope to accomplish. So, the best way to start this book is to define what AI actually is, what it isn't, and how it connects to computers today. Remember, of course, the basis for what you expect from AI is a combination of how you define AI, the technology you have for implementing AI, and the goals you have for AI. Consequently, everyone sees AI differently. This book takes a middle-of-the-road approach by viewing AI from as many different perspectives as possible. It doesn't buy into the hype offered by proponents, nor does it indulge in the negativity espoused by detractors, so that you get the best possible view of AI as a technology. As a result, you may find that you have somewhat different expectations than those you encounter in this book, which is fine, but it's essential to consider what the technology can actually do for you rather than expect something it can't. Defining the term AI. Before you can use a term in any meaningful and useful way, you must have a definition for it. After all, if nobody agrees on a meaning, the term has none. It's just a collection of characters. Defining the idiom, a term whose meaning isn't clear from the meanings of its constituent elements, is especially important with technical terms that have received more than a little press coverage at various times in various ways. Remember, saying that AI is an artificial intelligence doesn't really tell you anything meaningful, which is why there are so many discussions and disagreements over this term. Yes, you can argue that what occurs is artificial, not having come from a natural source. However, the intelligence part is, at best, ambiguous. Even if you don't necessarily agree with the definition of AI as used in the sections that follow, this book uses AI according to that definition, and knowing it will help you follow the rest of the text more easily. Discerning intelligence. People define intelligence in many different ways. However, you can say that intelligence involves certain mental activities composed of the following activities. Learning. Having the ability to obtain and process new information. Reasoning. Being able to manipulate information in various ways. Understanding. Considering the result of information manipulation. Grasping truths. determining the validity of the manipulated information, seeing relationships, divining how validated data interacts with other data, considering meanings, applying truths to particular situations in a manner consistent with their relationship, separating fact from belief, determining whether the data is adequately supported by provable sources that can be demonstrated to be consistently valid. The list could easily get quite long, but even this list is relatively prone to interpretation by anyone who accepts it as viable. As you can see from the list, however, intelligence often follows a process that a computer system can mimic as part of a simulation. 1. Set a goal based on needs or wants. 2. Assess the value of any currently known information in support of the goal. 3. Gather additional information that could support the goal. 4. Manipulate the data such that it achieves a form consistent with existing information. 5. Define the relationships and truth values between existing and new information. 6. Determine whether the goal is achieved. 7. Modify the goal in light of the new data and its effect on the probability of success. 8. Repeat steps 2 through 7 as needed until the goal is achieved, found true, or the possibilities for achieving it are exhausted, found false. Remember, even though you can create algorithms and provide access to data in support of this process within a computer's capability to achieve intelligence is severely limited. For example, a computer is incapable of understanding anything because it relies on machine processes to manipulate data using pure math in a strictly mechanical fashion. Likewise, computers can't easily separate truth from mistruth, as described in Chapter 2. In fact, no computer can fully implement any of the mental activities described in the list that describes intelligence. As part of deciding what intelligence actually involves, categorizing intelligence is also helpful. Humans don't use just one type of intelligence, but rather rely on multiple intelligences to perform tasks. Howard Gardner of Harvard has defined a number of these types of intelligence, and knowing them helps you to relate them to the kinds of tasks that a computer can simulate as intelligence. Discovering four ways to define AI. As described in the previous section, the first concept that's important to understand is that AI doesn't really have anything to do with human intelligence. Yes, some AI is modeled to simulate human intelligence, but that's what it is, a simulation. When thinking about AI, notice an interplay between goal-seeking, data processing used to achieve that goal, and data acquisition used to better understand the goal. AI relies on algorithms to achieve a result that may or may not have anything to do with human goals or methods of achieving those goals. With this in mind, you can categorize AI in four ways. Acting humanly. When a computer acts like a human, it best reflects the Turing test, in which the computer succeeds when differentiation between the computer and a human isn't possible. This category also reflects what the media would have you believe AI is all about. You see it employed for technologies such as natural language processing, knowledge representation, automated reasoning, and machine learning, all four of which must be present to pass the test. The original Turing test didn't include any physical contact. The newer total Turing test does include physical contact in the form of perceptual ability interrogation, which means that the computer must also employ both computer vision and robotics to succeed. Modern techniques include the idea of achieving the goal rather than mimicking humans completely. For example, the Wright brothers didn't succeed in creating an airplane by precisely copying the flight of birds. Rather, the birds provided ideas that led to aerodynamics that eventually led to human flight. The goal is to fly. Both birds and humans achieve this goal, but they use different approaches. Thinking humanly. When a computer thinks as a human, it performs tasks that require intelligence, as contrasted with rote procedures from a human to succeed, such as driving a car. To determine whether a program thinks like a human, you must have some method of determining how humans think, which the cognitive modeling approach defines. This model relies on three techniques. Introspection. Detecting and documenting the techniques used to achieve goals by monitoring one's own thought processes. Psychological testing. Observing a person's behavior and adding it to a database of similar behaviors from other persons given a similar set of circumstances, goals, resources, and environmental conditions, among other things. Brain imaging. Monitoring brain activity directly through various mechanical means, such as computerized axial tomography, CAT, positron emission tomography, PET, magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, and magnetoencephalography, MEG. After creating a model, you can write a program that simulates the model. Given the amount of variability among human thought processes and the difficulty of accurately representing these thought processes as part of a program, the results are experimental at best. This category of thinking humanly is often used in psychology and other fields in which modeling the human thought process to create realistic simulations is essential. Thinking rationally. Studying how humans think using some standard enables the creation of guidelines that describe typical human behaviors. A person is considered rational when following these behaviors within certain levels of deviation. A computer that thinks rationally relies on the recorded behaviors to create a guide as to how to interact with an environment based on the data at hand. The goal of this approach is to solve problems logically when possible. In many cases, this approach would enable the creation of a baseline technique for solving a problem, which would then be modified to actually solve the problem. In other words, the solving of a problem in principle is often different from solving it in practice, but you still need a starting point. Acting rationally. Studying how humans act in given situations under specific constraints enables you to determine which techniques are both efficient and effective. A computer that acts rationally relies on the recorded actions to interact with an environment based on conditions, environmental factors, and existing data. As with rational thought, rational acts depend on a solution in principle which may not prove useful in practice. However, rational acts do provide a baseline upon which a computer can begin negotiating the successful completion of a goal. Human versus rational processes. Human processes differ from rational processes in their outcome. A process is rational if it always does the right thing based on the current information, given an ideal performance measure. In short, rational processes go by the book and assume that the book is actually correct. Human processes involve instinct, intuition, and other variables that don't necessarily reflect the book and may not even consider the existing data. As an example, the rational way to drive a car is to always follow the laws. However, traffic isn't rational. If you follow the laws precisely, you end up stuck somewhere because other drivers aren't following the laws precisely. To be successful, a self-driving car must therefore act humanly rather than rationally. The categories used to define AI offer a way to consider various uses for or ways to apply AI. Some of the systems used to classify AI by type are arbitrary and not distinct. For example, some groups view AI as either strong, generalized intelligence that can adapt to a variety of situations, or weak, specific intelligence designed to perform a particular task well. The problem with strong AI is that it doesn't perform any task well, while weak AI is too specific to perform tasks independently. Even so, just two type classifications won't do the job even in a general sense. The four classification types promoted by Arendt Hintze form a better basis for understanding AI. Reactive machines. The machines you see beating humans at chess or playing on game shows are examples of reactive machines. A reactive machine has no memory or experience upon which to base a decision. Instead, it relies on pure computational power and smart algorithms to recreate every decision every time. This is an example of a weak AI used for a specific purpose. Limited memory. A self-driving car or autonomous robot can't afford the time to make every decision from scratch. These machines rely on a small amount of memory to provide experiential knowledge of various situations. When the machine sees the same situation, it can rely on experience to reduce reaction time and to provide more resources for making new decisions that haven't yet been made. This is an example of the current level of strong AI. Theory of mind. A machine that can assess both its required goals and the potential goals of other entities in the same environment has a kind of understanding that is feasible to some extent today, but not in any commercial form. However, for self-driving cars to become truly autonomous, this level of AI must be fully developed. A self-driving car would not only need to know that it must go from one point to another, but also intuit the potentially conflicting goals of drivers around it and react accordingly. Self-awareness. This is the sort of AI that you see in movies. However, it requires technologies that aren't even remotely possible now because such a machine would have a sense of both self and consciousness. In addition, instead of merely intuiting the goals of others based on environment and other entity reactions, this type of machine would be able to infer the intent of others based on experiential knowledge. Understanding the history of AI. The previous sections of this chapter help you understand intelligence from the human perspective and see how modern computers are woefully inadequate for simulating such intelligence, much less actually becoming intelligent themselves. However, the desire to create intelligent machines, or in ancient times, idols, is as old as humans. The desire not to be alone in the universe, to have something with which to communicate without the inconsistencies of other humans, is a strong one. Of course, a single book can't contemplate all of human history, so the following sections provide a brief, pertinent overview of the history of modern AI attempts. Starting with symbolic logic at Dartmouth. The earliest computers were just that, computing devices. They mimicked the human ability to manipulate symbols in order to perform basic math tasks such as addition. Logical reasoning later added the capability to perform mathematical reasoning through comparisons, such as determining whether one value is greater than another value. However, humans still needed to define the algorithm used to perform the computation, provide the required data in the right format, and then interpret the result. During the summer of 1956, various scientists attended a workshop held on the Dartmouth College campus to do something more. They predicted that machines that could reason as effectively as humans would require, at most, a generation to come about. They were wrong. Only now have we realized machines that can perform mathematical and logical reasoning as effectively as a human, which means that computers must master at least 6 more intelligences before reaching anything even close to human intelligence. The stated problem with the Dartmouth College and other endeavors of the time relates to hardware, the processing capability to perform calculations quickly enough to create a simulation. However, that's not really the whole problem. Yes, hardware does figure into the picture, but you can't simulate processes that you don't understand. Even so, the reason that AI is somewhat effective today is that the hardware has finally become powerful enough to support the required number of calculations. Warning. The biggest problem with these early attempts, and a still considerable problem today, is that we don't understand how humans reason well enough to create a simulation of any sort, assuming that a direction simulation is even possible. Consider again the issues surrounding manned flight described earlier in the chapter. The Wright brothers succeeded not by simulating birds, but rather by understanding the processes that birds use, thereby creating the field of aerodynamics. Consequently, when someone says that the next big AI innovation is right around the corner, and yet no concrete dissertation exists of the processes involved, the innovation is anything but right around the corner. Continuing with expert systems. Expert systems first appeared in the 1970s and again in the 1980s as an attempt to reduce the computational requirements posed by AI using the knowledge of experts. A number of expert system representations appeared, including rule-based, which use if-then statements to base decisions on rules of thumb, frame-based, which use databases organized into related hierarchies of generic information called frames, and logic-based, which rely on set theory to establish relationships. The advent of expert systems is important because they present the first truly useful and successful implementations of AI. Tip: you still see expert systems in use today, even though they aren't called that any longer. For example, the spelling and grammar checkers in your applications are kinds of expert systems. The grammar checker, especially, is strongly rule-based. It pays to look around to see other places where expert systems may still see practical use in everyday applications. A problem with expert systems is that they can be hard to create and maintain. Early users had to learn specialized programming languages such as list processing, Lisp, or Prolog. Some vendors saw an opportunity to put expert systems in the hands of less experienced or novice programmers by using products such as VP Expert, which rely on the rule-based approach. However, these products generally provided extremely limited functionality in using smallish knowledge bases. In the 1990s, the phrase expert system began to disappear. The idea that expert systems were a failure did appear, but the reality is that expert systems were simply so successful that they became ingrained in the applications that they were designed to support. Using the example of a word processor, At one time, you needed to buy a separate grammar checking application, such as WriteWriter. However, word processors now have grammar checkers built in because they proved so useful, if not always accurate. Overcoming the AI winters. The term AI winter refers to a period of reduced funding in the development of AI. In general, AI has followed a path on which proponents overstate what is possible, inducing people with no technology knowledge at all, but lots of money to make investments. A period of criticism then follows when AI fails to meet expectations, and finally, the reduction in funding occurs. A number of these cycles have occurred over the years, all of them devastating to true progress. AI is currently in a new hype phase because of machine learning, a technology that helps computers learn from data. Having a computer learn from data means not depending on a human programmer to set operations, tasks, but rather deriving them directly from examples that show how the computer should behave. It's like educating a baby by showing it how to behave through example. Machine learning has pitfalls because the computer can learn how to do things incorrectly through careless teaching. 5 tribes of scientists are working on machine learning algorithms, each one from a different point of view. See the Avoiding AI Hype section later in this chapter for details. At this time, the most successful solution is deep learning, which is a technology that strives to imitate the human brain. Deep learning is possible because of the availability of powerful computers, smarter algorithms, large data sets produced by the digitization of our society, and huge investments from businesses such as Google, Facebook, Amazon, and others that take advantage of this AI renaissance for their own businesses. People are saying that the AI winter is over because of deep learning, and that's true for now. However, when you look around at the ways in which people are viewing AI, you can easily figure out that another criticism phase will eventually occur unless proponents tone the rhetoric down. AI can do amazing things, but they're a mundane sort of amazing, as described in the next section. Considering AI uses. You find AI used in a great many applications today. The only problem is that the technology works so well that you don't know that it even exists. In fact, you might be surprised to find that many devices in your home already make use of AI. For example, some smart thermostats automatically create schedules for you based on how you manually control the temperature. Likewise, voice input that is used to control some devices learns how you speak so that it can better interact with you. AI definitely appears in your car, and most especially in the workplace. In fact, the uses for AI number in the millions, all safely out of sight even when they're quite dramatic in nature. Here are just a few of the ways in which you might see AI used. Fraud detection. You get a call from your credit card company asking whether you made a particular purchase. The credit card company isn't being nosy. It's simply alerting you to the fact that someone else could be making a purchase using your card. The AI embedded within the credit card company's code detected an unfamiliar spending pattern and alerted someone to it. Resource scheduling. Many organizations need to schedule the use of resources efficiently. For example, a hospital may have to determine where to put a patient based on the patient's needs, availability of skilled experts, and the amount of time the doctor expects the patient to be in the hospital. Complex analysis. Humans often need help with complex analysis because there are literally too many factors to consider. For example, the same set of symptoms could indicate more than one problem. A doctor or other expert might need help making a diagnosis in a timely manner to save a patient's life. Automation. Any form of automation can benefit from the addition of AI to handle unexpected changes or events. A problem with some types of automation today is that an unexpected event, such as an object in the wrong place, can actually cause the automation to stop. Adding AI to the automation can allow the automation to handle unexpected events and continue as if nothing happened. Customer service. The customer service line you call today may not even have a human behind it. The automation is good enough to follow scripts and use various resources to handle the vast majority of your questions. With good voice inflection, provided by AI as well, you may not even be able to tell that you're talking with a computer. Safety systems. Many of the safety systems found in machines of various sorts today rely on AI to take over the vehicle in a time of crisis. For example, many automatic braking systems rely on AI to stop the car based on all the inputs that a vehicle can provide, such as the direction of a skid. Machine efficiency. AI can help control a machine in such a manner as to obtain maximum efficiency. The AI controls the use of resources so that the system doesn't overshoot speed or other goals. Every ounce of power is used precisely as needed to provide the desired services. Avoiding AI hype. This chapter mentions AI hype quite a lot. Unfortunately, the chapter doesn't even scratch the surface of all the hype out there. If you watch movies such as Her and Ex Machina, you might be led to believe that AI is further along than it is. The problem is that AI is actually in its infancy, and any sort of application such as those shown in the movies is a creative output of an overactive imagination. You may have heard of something called the singularity, which is responsible for the potential claims presented in the media and movies. The singularity is essentially a master algorithm that encompasses all five tribes of learning used within machine learning. To achieve what these sources are telling you, the machine must be able to learn as a human would, as specified by the seven kinds of intelligence discussed in the discerning intelligence section early in the chapter. Here are the five tribes of learning. Symbolists. The origin of this tribe is in logic and philosophy. This group relies on inverse deduction to solve problems. Connectionists. This tribe's origin is in neuroscience, and the group relies on backpropagation to solve problems. Evolutionaries. The evolutionaries' tribe originates in evolutionary biology, relying on genetic programming to solve problems. Bayesians. This tribe's origin is in statistics and relies on probabilistic inference to solve problems. Analogizers. The origin of this tribe is in psychology. The group relies on kernel machines to solve problems. The ultimate goal of machine learning is to combine the technologies and strategies embraced by the five tribes to create a single algorithm, the master algorithm, that can learn anything. Of course, achieving that goal is a long way off. Even so, scientists such as Pedro Domingos are currently working toward that goal. To make things even less clear, the five tribes may not be able to provide enough information to actually solve the problem of human intelligence, so creating master algorithms for all five tribes may still not yield the singularity. At this point, you should be amazed at just how much people don't know about how they think, or why they think in a certain manner. Any rumors you hear about AI taking over the world or becoming superior to people are just plain false. Connecting AI to the underlying computer. To see AI at work, you need to have some sort of computing system, an application that contains the required software, and a knowledge base. The computing system could be anything with a chip inside. In fact, a smartphone does just as well as a desktop computer for some applications. Of course, if you're Amazon and you want to provide advice on a particular person's next buying decision, the smartphone won't do. You need a really big computing system for that application. The size of the computing system is directly proportional to the amount of work you expect the AI to perform. The application can also vary in size, complexity, and even location. For example, if you are a business and want to analyze client data to determine how best to make a sales pitch, you might rely on a server-based application to perform the task. On the other hand, if you are a customer and want to find products on Amazon to go with your current purchase items, the application doesn't even reside on your computer. You access it through a web-based application located on Amazon's servers. The knowledge base varies in location and size as well. The more complex the data, the more you can obtain from it, but the more you need to manipulate it as well. You get no free lunch when it comes to knowledge management. The interplay between location and time is also important. A network connection affords you access to a large knowledge base online, but costs you in time because of the latency of network connections. However, localized databases, while fast, tend to lack details in many cases. Chapter 2. Defining the role of data. There is nothing new about data. Every interesting application ever written for a computer has data associated with it. Data comes in many forms, some organized, some not. What has changed is the amount of data. Some people find it almost terrifying that we now have access to so much data that details nearly every aspect of most people's lives, sometimes to a level that even the person doesn't realize. In addition, the use of advanced hardware and improvements in algorithms makes data the universal resource for AI today. To work with data, you must first obtain it. Today, applications collect data manually, as done in the past, and also automatically using new methods. However, it's not a matter of just one or two data collection techniques. Collection methods take place on a continuum from fully manual to fully automatic. Raw data doesn't usually work well for analysis purposes. This chapter also helps you understand the need for manipulating and shaping the data so that it meets specific requirements. You also discover the need to define the truth value of the data to ensure that analysis outcomes match the goals set for applications in the first place. Interestingly, you also have data acquisition limits to deal with. No technology currently exists for grabbing thoughts from someone's mind through telepathic means. Of course, other limits exist too, most of which you probably already know about but may not have considered. Finding data ubiquitous in this age. More than a buzzword used by vendors to propose new ways to store data and analyze it, the big data revolution is an everyday reality and a driving force of our times. You may have heard big data mentioned in many specialized scientific and business publications and even wondered what the term really means. From a technical perspective, big data refers to large and complex amounts of computer data, so large and intricate that applications can't deal with the data by using additional storage or increasing computer power. Big data implies a revolution in data storage and manipulation. It affects what you can achieve with data in more qualitative terms. In addition to doing more, you can perform tasks better. Computers store big data in different formats from a human perspective, but the computer sees data as a stream of ones and zeros, the core language of computers. You can view data as being one of the two types, depending on how you produce and consume it. Some data has a clear structure. You know exactly what it contains and where to find every piece of data, whereas other data is unstructured. You have an idea of what it contains, but you don't know exactly how it is arranged. Typical examples of structured data are database tables, in which information is arranged into columns and each column contains a specific type of information. Data is often structured by design. You gather it selectively and record it in its correct place. For example, you might want to place a count of the number of people buying a certain product in a specific column in a specific table in a specific database. As with a library, if you know what data you need, you can find it immediately. Unstructured data consists of images, videos, and sound recordings. You may use an unstructured form for text so that you can tag it with characteristics such as size, date, or content type. Usually, you don't know exactly where data appears in an unstructured data set because the data appears as sequences of ones and zeros that an application must interpret or visualize. Remember, transforming unstructured data into a structured form can cost lots of time and effort and can involve the work of many people. Most of the data of the big data revolution is unstructured and stored as it is unless someone renders it structured. This copious and sophisticated data store didn't appear suddenly overnight. It took time to develop the technology to store this amount of data. In addition, it took time to spread the technology that generates and delivers data, namely computers, sensors, smart mobile phones, the internet, and its World Wide Web services. The following sections help you understand what makes data a universal resource today. Understanding Moore's implications. In 1965, Gordon Moore, co-founder of Intel and Fairchild Semiconductor, wrote in an article entitled "Cramming More Components Onto Integrated Circuits" that the number of components found in integrated circuits would double every year for the next decade. At that time, transistors dominated electronics. Being able to stuff more transistors into an integrated circuit, IC, meant being able to make electronic devices more capable and useful. This process is called integration and implies a stronger process of electronics miniaturization, making the same circuit much smaller. Today's computers aren't all that much smaller than computers of a decade ago, but they are decisively more powerful. The same goes for mobile phones. Even though they're the same size as their predecessors, they have become able to perform more tasks. What Moore stated in that article has actually been true for many years. The semiconductor industry calls it Moore's Law. Doubling did occur for the first 10 years as predicted. In 1975, Moore corrected his statement, forecasting a doubling every 2 years. This rate of doubling is still valid, although now it's common opinion that it won't hold longer than the end of the present decade, up to about 2020. Starting in 2012, a mismatch began to occur between expected speed increases and what semiconductor companies can achieve with regard to miniaturization. Physical barriers exist to integrating more circuits on an IC using the present silica components because you can make things only so small. However, innovation continues. In the future, Moore's Law may not apply because industry will switch to a new technology, such as making components by using optical lasers instead of transistors. What matters is that since 1965, the doubling of components every 2 years has ushered in great advancements in digital electronics that has had far-reaching consequences in the acquisition, storage, manipulation, and management of data. Moore's law has a direct effect on data. It begins with smarter devices. The smarter the devices, the more diffusion, as evidenced by electronics being everywhere today. The greater the diffusion, the lower the price becomes, creating an endless loop that drives the use of powerful computing machines and small sensors everywhere. With large amounts of computer memory available and larger storage disks for data, the consequences are an expansion of data availability, such as websites, transaction records, measurements, digital images, and other sorts of data. Using data everywhere. Scientists need more powerful computers than the average person because of their scientific experiments. They began dealing with impressive amounts of data years before anyone coined the term big data. At this point, the internet didn't produce the vast sums of data that it does today. Remember that big data isn't a fad created by software and hardware vendors, but has a basis in many scientific fields such as astronomy, space missions, satellite, surveillance and monitoring, meteorology, physics, particle accelerators, and genomics, DNA sequences. Although AI applications can specialize in a scientific field, such as IBM's Watson, which boasts an impressive medical diagnosis capability because it can learn information from millions of scientific papers on diseases and medicine, the actual AI application driver often has more mundane facets. Actual AI applications are mostly prized for being able to recognize objects, move along paths, or understand what people say to them. Data contribution to the actual AI renaissance that molded it in such a fashion didn't derive from the classical sources of scientific data. The internet now generates and distributes new data in large amounts. Our current daily data production is estimated to amount to about 2.5 quintillion, a number with 18 zeros, bytes, with the lion's share going to unstructured data like videos and audios. All this data is related to common human activities, feelings, experiences, and relations. Roaming through this data, an AI can easily learn how reasoning and acting more human-like works. Here are some examples of the more interesting data you can find. Large repositories of faces and expressions from photos and videos posted on social media websites like Facebook, YouTube, and Google provide information about gender, age, feelings, and possibly sexual preferences, political orientations, or IQ. Privately held medical information and biometric data from smartwatches, which measure body data such as temperature and heart rate during both illness and good health. Datasets of how people relate to each other and what drives their interest from sources such as social media and search engines. For instance, a study from Cambridge University's Psychometric Center claims that Facebook interactions contain a lot of data about intimate relationships. Information on how we speak is recorded by mobile phones. For instance, OK Google, a function found on Android mobile phones, routinely records questions and sometimes even more. Every day, users connect even more devices to the internet that start storing new personal data. There are now personal assistants that sit in houses such as Amazon Echo and other integrated smart home devices that offer ways to regulate and facilitate the domestic environment. These are just the tip of the iceberg because many other common tools of everyday life are becoming interconnected, from the refrigerator to the toothbrush, and able to process, record, and transmit data. The Internet of Things, IoT, is becoming a reality. Experts estimate that by 2020, 6 times as many connected things will exist as there will be people. But research teams and think tanks are already revisiting those figures. Putting algorithms into action. The human race is now at an incredible intersection of unprecedented volumes of data generated by increasingly smaller and powerful hardware. The data is also increasingly processed and analyzed by the same computers that the process helped spread and develop. This statement may seem obvious, but data has become so ubiquitous that its value no longer resides only in the information it contains, such as the case of data stored in a firm's database that allows its daily operations, but rather in its use as a means to create new values. Such data is described as the new oil. These new values mostly exist in how applications manicure, store, and retrieve data, and in how you actually use it by means of smart algorithms. Algorithms and AI changed the data game. As mentioned in the previous chapter, AI algorithms have tried different approaches along the way, passing from simple algorithms to symbolic reasoning based on logic, and then to expert systems. In recent years, they became neural networks, and in their most mature form, deep learning. As this methodological passage happened, data turned from being the information processed by predetermined algorithms to becoming what molded the algorithm into something useful for the task. Data turned from being just the raw material that fueled the solution to the artisan of the solution itself. Thus, a photo of some of your kittens has become increasingly useful not simply just because of its effective value, depicting your cute little cats, but because it could become part of the learning process of an AI discovering more general concepts such as what characteristics denote a cat or understanding what defines cute. On a larger scale, a company like Google feeds its algorithms from freely available data, such as the content of websites or the text found in publicly available texts and books. Google Spider software crawls the web, jumping from website to website, retrieving web pages with their content of text and images. Even if Google gives back part of the data to users as search results, it extracts other kinds of information from the data using its AI algorithms, which learn from it how to achieve other objectives. Algorithms that process words can help Google AI systems understand and anticipate your needs even when you are not expressing them in a set of keywords but in plain, unclear natural language, the language we speak every day. And yes, everyday language is often unclear. If you currently try to pose questions, not just chains of keywords, to the Google search engine, you'll notice that it tends to answer correctly. Since 2012, with the introduction of the Hummingbird update, Google became better able to understand synonyms and concepts, something that goes beyond the initial data that it acquired, and this is the result of an AI process. An even more advanced algorithm exists in Google named Rank Brain, which learns directly from millions of queries every day, and can answer ambiguous or unclear search queries, even expressed in slang or colloquial terms or simply ridden with errors. Rank Brain doesn't service all the queries, but it learns from data how to better answer queries. It already handles 15% of the engine's queries, and in the future, this percentage could become 100%. Using data successfully. Having plentiful data available isn't enough to create a successful AI. Presently, an AI algorithm can't extract information directly from raw data. Most algorithms rely on external collection and manipulation prior to analysis. When an algorithm collects useful information, it may not represent the right information. The following sections help you understand how to collect, manipulate, and automate data collection from an overview perspective. Considering the data sources. The data you use comes from a number of sources. The most common data source is from information entered by humans at some point. Even when a system collects shopping site data automatically, humans initially enter the information. A human clicks various items, adds them to a shopping cart, specifies characteristics such as size and quantity, and then checks out. Later, after the sale, the human gives the shopping experience, product and delivery method a rating, and makes comments. In short, every shopping experience becomes a data collection exercise as well. Many data sources today rely on input gathered from human sources. Humans also provide manual input. You call or go into an office somewhere to make an appointment with a professional. A receptionist then gathers information from you that's needed for the appointment. This manually collected data eventually ends up in a dataset somewhere for analysis purposes. Data is also collected from sensors, and these sensors can take almost any form. For example, many organizations base physical data collection, such as the number of people viewing an object in a window, on cell phone detection. Facial recognition software could potentially detect repeat customers. However, sensors can create datasets from almost anything. The Weather Service relies on datasets created by sensors that monitor environmental conditions such as rain, temperature, humidity, cloud cover, and so on. Robotic monitoring systems help correct small flaws in robotic operation by constantly analyzing data collected by monitoring sensors. A sensor combined with a small AI application could tell you when your dinner is cooked to perfection tonight. The sensor collects data, but the AI application uses rules to help define when the food is properly cooked. Obtaining reliable data. The word reliable seems so easy to define, yet so hard to implement. Something is reliable when the results it produces are both expected and consistent. A reliable data source produces mundane data that contains no surprises. No one is shocked in the least by the outcome. Depending on your perspective, it could actually be a good thing that most people aren't yawning and then falling asleep when reviewing data. The surprises make the data worth analyzing and reviewing. Consequently, data has an aspect of duality. We want reliable, mundane, fully anticipated data that simply confirms what we already know, but the unexpected is what makes collecting the data useful in the first place. Still, you don't want data that is so far out of the ordinary that it becomes almost frightening to review. Balance needs to be maintained when obtaining data. The data must fit within certain limits, as described in the Manicuring the Data section later in this chapter. It must also meet specific criteria as to truth value, as described in the Considering the Five Mistruths in Data section later in this chapter. The data must also come at unexpected intervals, and all the fields of the incoming data record must be complete. Remember, To some extent, data security also affects data reliability. Data consistency comes in several forms. When the data arrives, you can ensure that it falls within expected ranges and appears in a particular form. However, after you store the data, the reliability can decrease unless you ensure that the data remains in the expected form. An entity fiddling with the data affects reliability, making the data suspect and potentially unusable for analysis later. Ensuring data reliability means that after the data arrives, no one tampers with it to make it fit within an expected domain, making it mundane as a result. Making human input more reliable. Humans make mistakes. It's part of being human. In fact, expecting that humans won't make mistakes is unreasonable. Yet many application designs assume that humans somehow won't make mistakes of any sort. The design expects that everyone will simply follow the rules. Unfortunately, the vast majority of users are guaranteed to not even read the rules because most humans are also lazy or too pressed for time when it comes to doing things that don't really help them directly. Consider the entry of a state into a form. If you provide just a text field, some users might input the entire state name, such as Kansas. Of course, some users will make a typo or capitalization error and come up with Kansas with a U, or lowercase k, capital A-N-S-A-S. Setting these errors, people and organizations have various approaches to performing tasks. Someone in the publishing industry might use the Associated Press, AP style guide, and input KAN. Someone who is older and used to the government printing office, GPO guidelines, might input KANS instead. Other abbreviations are used as well. The U.S. Post Office, USPS, uses KS, but the U.S. Coast Guard uses KA. Meanwhile, the International Standards Organization, ISO, form goes with US-KS. Mind you, this is just a state entry which is reasonably straightforward, or so you thought before listening to this section. Clearly, because the state isn't going to change names anytime soon, you could simply provide a drop-down list box on the form for choosing the state in the required format, thereby eliminating differences in abbreviation use, typos, and capitalization errors in one fell swoop. Remember, drop-down list boxes work well for an amazing array of data inputs, and using them ensures that human input into those fields becomes extremely reliable because the human has no choice but to use one of the default entries. Of course, the human can always choose the incorrect entry, which is where double checks come into play. Some newer applications compare the zip code to the city and state entries to see whether they match. When they don't match, the user is asked again to provide the correct input. This double check verges on being annoying, but the user is unlikely to see it very often, so it shouldn't become too annoying. Even with cross-checks and static entries, humans still have plenty of room for making mistakes. For example, entering numbers can be problematic. When a user needs to enter 2.00, you might see 2, or 2.0, or 2. Or any of a variety of other entries. Fortunately, parsing the entry and reformatting it will fix the problem, and you can perform the task automatically without the user's aid. Unfortunately, reformatting won't correct an errant numeric input. You can partially mitigate such errors by including range checks. A customer can't buy -5 bars of soap. The legitimate way to show the customer returning the bars of soap is to process a return, not a sale. However, the user might have simply made an error, and you can provide a message stating the proper input range for the value. Using automated data collection. Some people think that automated data collection solves all the human input issues associated with data sets. In fact, automated data collection does provide a number of benefits: better consistency, improved reliability, lower probability of missing data, enhanced accuracy, reduced variance for things like timed inputs. Unfortunately, to say that automated data collection solves every issue is simply incorrect. Automated data collection still relies on sensors, applications, and computer hardware designed by humans that provide access only to the data that humans decide to allow. Because of the limits that humans place on the characteristics of automated data collection, the outcome often provides less helpful information than hoped for by the designers. Consequently, automated data collection is in a constant state of flux as designers try to solve the input issues. Automated data collection also suffers from both software and hardware errors present in any computing system, but with a higher potential for soft issues, which arise when the system is apparently working but isn't providing the desired result, than other kinds of computer-based setups. When the system works, the reliability of the input far exceeds human abilities. However, when soft issues occur, the system often fails to recognize that a problem exists, as a human might, and therefore the data set could end up containing more mediocre or even bad data. Manicuring the data. Some people use the term manipulation when speaking about data, giving the impression that the data is somehow changed in an unscrupulous or devious manner. Perhaps a better term would be manicuring, which makes the data well-shaped and lovely. No matter what term you use, however, raw data seldom meets the requirements for processing and analysis. To get something out of the data, you must manicure it to meet specific needs. The following sections discuss data manicuring needs. Dealing with missing data. To answer a given question correctly, you must have all the facts. You can guess the answer to a question without all the facts, but then the answer is just as likely to be wrong as correct. Often, someone who makes a decision, essentially answering a question without all the facts, is said to jump to a conclusion. When analyzing data, you have probably jumped to more conclusions than you think because of missing data. A data record, one entry in a data set, which is all the data, consists of fields that contain facts used to answer a question. Each field contains a single kind of data that addresses a single fact. If that field is empty, you don't have the data you need to answer the question using that particular data record. Remember, as part of the process of dealing with missing data, you must know that the data is missing. Identifying that your data set is missing information can actually be quite hard because it requires you to look at the data at a low level, something that most people aren't prepared to do and is time-consuming even if you do have the required skills. Often your first clue that data is missing is the preposterous answers that your questions get from the algorithm and associated data set. When the algorithm is the right one to use, the data set must be at fault. A problem can occur when the data collection process doesn't include all the data needed to answer a particular question. Sometimes you're better off to actually drop a fact rather than to use a considerably damaged fact. If you find that a particular field in a data set is missing 90% or more of its data, The field becomes useless, and you need to drop it from the dataset, or find some way to obtain all that data. Less damaged fields can have data missing in one of two ways. Randomly missing data is often the result of human or sensor error. It occurs when data records throughout the dataset have missing entries. Sometimes a simple glitch will cause the damage. Sequentially missing data occurs during some type of generalized failure. An entire segment of the data records in the dataset lack the required information, which means that the resulting analysis can become quite skewed. Fixing randomly missing data is easiest. You can use a simple median or average value as a replacement. No, the dataset isn't completely accurate, but it will likely work well enough to obtain a reasonable answer. In some cases, data scientists used a special algorithm to compute the missing value, which can make the dataset more accurate at the expense of computational time. Sequentially missing data is significantly harder, if not impossible, to fix because you lack any surrounding data on which to base any sort of guess. If you can find the cause of the missing data, you can sometimes reconstruct it. However, when reconstruction becomes impossible, you can choose to ignore the field. Unfortunately, some answers will require that field, which means that you might need to ignore that particular sequence of data records, potentially causing incorrect output. Considering data misalignments. Data might exist for each of the data records in a data.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.